In the next edition of It's About Money, my guest will be Kurt Feuerherm. He is an artistic genius. He's a painter, sculptor, educator, mentor, just a terrific guy. I'm looking forward to having him as my guest in the next edition of It's About Money. Hello and welcome to It's About Money. I'm Nannette Nocon and thank you for joining us. It is my pleasure to have Kurt Feuerherm join me as my guest, an outstanding artist of several decades, and I'm just really impressed by your work.
Thank you, Nannette.
So thank you. So you're a painter, sculptor, educator, mentor. How did your love for art begin?
Well, that's an interesting story because I was a World War II veteran. I fought in Italy, and when I was after, I lived in Buffalo, and I joined the, or I was drafted into the Army right after high school. So I didn't have, I had a sort of an art background, but it was mostly in commercial art, and I didn't have any idea of what fine arts was. So after I got discharged, for about 6 months, I didn't do anything, and then finally, I decided that I have to do something with my life. So a friend of mine, his brother, had a portfolio of things that he did, and he went to the Albright Art School, which was in Buffalo, New York, and now it's part of SUNY Buffalo. I went there with him just to accompany him, and while he was being interviewed by the director to see if he could get into the fall semester, I walked around in the Albright Art School, into the painting room, and I guess I loved the smell of turpentine. I thought it was just wonderful because this is where I want to be. So I enrolled, I asked the director if I could bring my portfolio over, and I did. He went through it, and he wasn't very impressed, but there were two little paintings there. He said, "Tell me about these, Kurt." And I said, "Well, these are really my sort of imaginary and so forth." He says, "Well," he says, "these two paintings will get you into the school. They're very creative, and we like that kind of thing." So I started there, and then in my freshman year, his wife was teaching a painting class. Her name was Virginia Cuthbert, and she was a very well-known artist. And about halfway through, she says, "Kurt," she said, "have you ever thought about being a painter?" I said, "What's that?" So she explained it to me, and I think that's what really sort of... after that, I realized that's what I wanted to be.
They're meant to be, and you're so talented.
Yeah.
So that's when you... when did you realize that you can be an artist make a living?
I think my mentor, Seymour Drumlevich, who was my painting teacher in my junior and senior year, sort of... encouraged me. I went to Mexico in 1949, and I brought back about five or six sketchbooks full of sketches, and he looked at him. He says, you have enough material here to last you a lifetime. Mm. And it was sort of a breakthrough kind of thing. And he talked to me about how to develop the sketches into paintings and so forth. And
nice.
He was just very encouraging, and he was, I always call him my intellectual father, because he really opened up the whole spectrum of what you can do in art, you know.
Now, how do you transition? You started out as a painter, right?
Yes.
And then how did you transition from painter to sculptor, and you are back and forth anyway, and...
Well, I didn't really get interested in sculpture until in the 1960s when I, at that time I was showing at Shop One, the original Shop One.
Sure, yes.
And I met two brothers that were ceramists, Phil and Jim Seacrest.
Okay.
And they said, would you like to work in ceramic, Kurt? And we've just sort of hit it off. Mm-hmm. So I went to their studio in the Bristol Hills, sort of south of Honey Eye. I just loved working there. And I realized that working in clay was very similar to working in marzipan.
A marzipan.
Yeah. Now, my dad was a candy maker, and we had a candy store, and I made tons and tons of marzipan.
I see. Oh, that's a good analogy, and I love marzipan.
Yeah, and the clay had the same kind of texture, and I was able to, you know, relate to it that way. Because I tried throwing when I was at Cranbrook. I was in a ceramic class, and I did do throw a few pots, but that didn't really
do it for you.
Do it for me. You
know, I
this was much more building and sculpting.
Got it.
It was much more direct for me than throwing a pot.
Yeah, actually, and I want to talk about the owl series that you have, and I think it's just so beautiful. And I'm pleased that we have some photographs to show of the owl work that you have. And so how did you decide to, because owl is like wise, right? How did you decide to use this particular way of
birds,
doing sculpture?
Birds have always, my second, if I hadn't become a painter, when I went to Yale University, I took some paleontology and a couple science courses. And I've always been interested in nature.
I'm
a fisherman, and I love turning rocks over to see what's under it.
I see, okay, you all know. Right.
I don't look at the sky.
Yeah, right. And like this one, blue, it's just so beautiful. I love that the way this looks like it has legs and... And it's like, do you see the vision in your mind, or how do you
actually? Oh, well, yes. I start out with the clay, and then I have tools, like sometimes they're just sticks of wood that I work on it and build up the texture, and it suggests whatever bird it's going to be. You know, I do other birds besides owls.
Of course.
Animals. And,
and there's so many. I think they're magnificent. I love the eyes. That's great. Now, did you ever doubt that you want to be a professional artist?
No, I don't think doubt has ever come in my mind. I mean, the hardest thing is to... I wouldn't say, you're not going to make an awful lot of money unless you're in New York and you finally connect with a very good gallery. Mm-hmm. But I think it's always something, and I love it now. I'm 91 years old and I'm still working, and it's, I don't feel retired.
Yeah, I think it's great. I mean, they say anyway, retirement is doing something you love, right?
So, right.
And that's, you're doing that.
Yeah.
That's great. And now your work is part of the permanent collections of MoMA, the MAG in Rochester. And how did you make that leap? Did they discover you? Did you show your portfolio? How does an artist?
Well, I think I started out by local shows, like the Western New York show, which is like the Finger Lakes show here. Uh-huh. And that's how you sort of started out. And in those days, there were many, many more national programs you could get in. And, it's changed so much because now it's all done by digital photography. You have to send in slides. I don't like that as much because I liked it when a painter could look at your painting to see the surface and what it is. And to mm-hmm. judge just from slides is very difficult.
I see. And what we have here is your series from Florida, right? The Palm series?
Yes, that's a recent work that I did this last winter. And it's based on patterns of the photographs that I take myself, and then I put them into the computer and then work on them with a program called Photo Studio.
Wow.
And so I feel it's all original work because I took the photograph.
Sure.
But I don't, that's one way of doing it. Sometimes I just do it by a drawing, by scanning in a drawing, or other times I just start from scratch.
I see.
So there's many ways you can start. And then when I get the image done, I save it onto my flash drive and take it over to my printer, Mike Hager, who's a wonderful printer, and we do G-clay, which is, he uses very soft inks, so they come out looking much more like a silk screen.
Ah.
And so that's, you know, it's a jet ink print, but I think it's a wonderful way to work. But I also use those images sometimes and put them on a board or a canvas and work back into them.
Ah, some texture and stuff.
Yes,
oh,
yeah.
I see.
And then they become one of a kind instead of a series of prints.
I see. So I love that it's, you know, it can be any direction, any way you want it. You just have to be creative about how you produce it. That's great. Now, this particular one, did you also do this art through a studio, photo studio, or is this one?
No, this is an acrylic collage, which was based on Arizona landscape.
Uh-huh.
And actually, I call it my, I can't think of the big Grand Canyon series.
Okay.
What amazed me about the Grand Canyon was that it's such a flat landscape, and you don't really get to see the canyon until you walk up to the rim. And then all at once, wow!
Right. Surprises down there, right.
Yeah. And so a lot of these are just looking into the canyon. You just sort of see the rim.
I see. Okay, I see.
And then I'm also interested in the erosion, textures, and all that kind of stuff. I'm not interested in doing a particular scene. I'm interested more in the essence of the landscape.
I see. Very nice. And I can see that. And the colors are vibrant, and they're just amazing. So it's good to have the artist's interpretation of what it's about. So. How does besides being an artist, you're also an educator. How did that influence your art in any way?
Well, I've always felt that I learned from my students as well as they learning from me,
mm-hmm.
And I like the fact that I try to understand what my students are doing so that I can help them in any way to solve a problem, I would say. You know, I think education is teaching somebody to how to solve a problem.
I see. And did it also afford you, like I would think that as an educator you have stability of income, and as an artist there's some variability with that, right? Because you could sell a bunch of pieces, but then none for a period of time. Would you say that had any role in allowing you to continue to your
Absolutely.
Art form?
Absolutely. I mean, because of education is, especially art education, is a one-on-one kind of teaching. You also had your whole summer. So I felt, you know, I had a family and I was able to see my children all summer and, you know, and also during the week. My I wasn't a 9-to-5 job. It was a job, you know, whenever my particular class was meeting, you know.
I see.
So it was never the same.
Got it.
From year to year. So it kept your interest up. Although, you know, after teaching at Empire State for 17 years at the SUNY school, that's a school basically for adult education. I mean, people that are coming back into the field so they can finish up their degree. it was just very fulfilling. You know, I liked it a lot. So.
That's great. We'll take a quick break. My guest is Kurt Feuerherm, and we're talking about his art. Quite a genius of an artist. We'll be right back. And we're back. I'm Nannette Nocon. It's About Money. My guest is Kurt Feuerherm, and he is a sculptor, a painter, educator, and a mentor. I'm really thrilled to have you here, Kurt. Let's talk about the exhibition that you had at Warren Phillips Gallery out here in Rochester, New York, not so long ago in 2016. Yeah. And you had, it was a joint exhibition with your wife, Judy.
Yes.
Tell me about that. I really enjoyed that show.
Well, for me, it was wonderful because I always wanted to have a show with my wife. And, you know, what was wonderful about it was that she was ready to have a show. So we got it together, and I thought it was wonderful. I've always felt I've been very supportive of her. I mean, she works in business mostly, mm-hmm. She was always interested in painting. She got a degree in painting from Empire State and Fine Arts, and then she went on for a journalism degree at Temple.
I see.
And then she went. And then she worked for Bill Rouse in Philadelphia, and because we had done some renovation on South Avenue, and she had a pretty good knowledge of renovation. And and then she went on to what she did in New York and Pennsylvania, or in the Northeast area.
You know? I see. Very nice. That's great. I really thought that was, it's wonderful to have two artists be together and help inspire each other.
Yeah,
we
even work in the same studio.
Oh, even better. that's great. That's great. So now what we have on screen here is part of your Italy series, right?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
I taught in Florence in 1966 and for 2 years. And I taught at a school called Polimoda, which was part of the FIT overseas program that they had for international students. And I had students from all over the world that they all could speak some English. And I could speak some Italian, but not, I wasn't very fluent in Italian. And it was a great experience. So at nighttime in my little apartment that I had in the north of Florence, I would do these small collages. Mm-hmm. Which were interpretations of places that I've been, you know, like an archway, and like this one is sort of an archway. Mm-hmm. And they're collages made up of pieces of postcard, old posters around Florence. They used to call me the mad stripper. In class, because I was always stripping off pieces of paper to put into my collages. And I did a series of images like this. They're all very small. They're not very large.
And, I see. They're beautiful. They're
yeah.
Very
and,
colorful.
Because I didn't have a studio, so I worked on the kitchen table. And,
No, how does marketing play into it? You sell your art website through exhibitions, and then just people knowing about your work. Right?
Well, I had a gallery for 30 years, the Oxford Gallery, and then when I moved out of town, I moved to Cape Cod. I sort of lost connections with that gallery, but usually I market my stuff through a gallery.
I see.
And so, you know, the one of the hardest things is the marketing part of it is how much does the gallery get and how much do you get, you know, and which has gone up and up and up. As, you know, when I first was in the galleries used to take 25%, mm-hmm. and now they take 50 or 60%.
Oh, my goodness.
And not, you know, this is not all galleries, but
sure,
these
sure,
are
sure.
professional galleries.
I see.
And you know, the overhead for them has gone sky high.
Oh, sure.
Because I had a partnership with Judy, my wife, and another friend, and we renovated a building on South Avenue, mm-hmm. and then put a craft gallery in there.
Oh.
And which was called Hoppers, and we had that for about 4 years.
I see.
And then things just changed for all of us, and we disbanded the gallery, but we still owned the building, and so we still rented spaces in the building.
Oh, nice. That's great. So you're really quite nimble in the things that you do. In your 90s, you're working with computers to do your art.
Yes.
And when you taught, you did art in between.
Oh.
So sometimes I encounter artists that have to have a block of time that they can be artistic. But it sounds like you're so fluid in how you do your art and when you do it.
Yes, that's true. And I think, you know, I'm not envious, but I know friends that do work that. They really work on it, you know, 8-9 hours a day or even more than that. I'm more of an artist that works in spurts.
I see.
You know, and I'm always thinking about art.
Uh-huh.
And it's always in my head. But, you know, and Judy says, I've never seen anybody who can go in there for 2 minutes and just do something and then come back and out and do something else. So.
That's great, though, because you might as well release the creative genius that's there and just kind of do a little bit of art and then move on to something else.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's great. That's a really terrific. Now, the collages that you've been doing, those are really neat. And you did some of them in Italy, but then you're back to doing different kind of collages.
Yes, I also have an eBay business.
Uh-huh.
And I sell a lot of photography on eBay because Judy and I collected photography and we've sold off most of our collection. But we also collected other, you know, whenever we go to a household sale or we go to a an antique show or something like that, photographic things are things that interest us. But I have a lot of very... you know, you get a box lot of photographs and some of them will be torn or they'll be bent and they have no value on eBay because of the condition.
I see.
So I decided to do photographic oriented collages with only 19th century material in it.
Uh-huh.
And because photography started in 1839, and that was the beginning of the photography era, and there's I would say 97% of the photographs that were taken are now anonymous because nobody ever said who it was, and you know, and if they're like broken glass plates or anything like that, I like to use them in the collage and work them up as, you know, as imagery.
Yeah, I love it. They're beautiful. I saw some of them and I think that's really great. Now, what advice would you give to a budding artist? There's, you know, some talented, not so talented, but then it's just the hurdle of do I do it, do I not do it? What kind of advice would you offer them?
Well, I'd have to really get to know them and, you know, to see, I think it's a wonderful thing to do. I mean, I've never tired of it. I think it has, I would advise them to do, to take a couple business courses, mm-hmm. especially marketing.
I see.
And because it's a tough field out there. There's a lot of artists, and it's hard to make a living. You know, I know ceramists, and I know craft people that have made a living from just their work. Outside of the top artists in New York City, I don't know a lot of artists that make enough from their work, but they're still doing art.
Sure.
So, you know, I would talk to them about that kind of thing. You know, you've got to realize that.
And perhaps weave in some other steady income, like if one studied.
Well, and I think teaching is important, mm-hmm. Because I think artists have always taught. I mean, in the Renaissance, it was a different system. It was called the apprentice system. And they would take in young people that they thought were talented, and they would learn it from the bottom up, you know. And
then once in a while, they'd encounter people who encouraged them, like you had some mentors. And
yeah, it was like, who I forgot exactly the connection, but Masaccio, I mean, one of his apprentices was one of the big artists, you know, uh-huh. like Michelangelo. I forgot which one it was, but
yes, okay.
Anyway, you know, that's the way you learn.
Sure, you never know how big they will get, so it's just
right.
Kind of
leading.
Right,
and many of them were family business, like Ghirlandaio, who was a great Florentine painter in my eyes, and his whole family painted. Now, and they don't, I mean, in those days, women didn't get very much credit for what they did creatively.
Sure, that's a tough time.
But there were many of them that had their daughters working.
I see. And then the father is the one whose name appears on the art form. Oh, interesting.
Yeah,
I guess that happened so much in that part of the time period where women composers, women artists, they're just sort of not important or not recognized, and then the men can take credit for it, but you know where it comes from. So.
Yeah,
that's great. You know, I'm just in awe of how much energy you have and how flexible you are and how you continue to grow and just be just continue to enjoy art. And I know that it's your passion as opposed to a job.
Yeah, I try to keep as open as possible. You know? I mean, it's sometimes difficult.
Yeah. Well, you're quite inspiring, Kurt, and I just want to say thank you for spending the time at my show today and showing some of your art as well. Thank you for saving the PDF files. And see, it's just, to me, it's amazing. You know, some people don't know how to even touch the computer. And in your 90 years, you know, you are continuing to learn. So that's amazing.
Well, the first computer lesson I took, the person said, just push the buttons and find out what happens.
Sage advice. That's great. And thank you. So we will end there. This is great. Just go do it, right?
Yeah.
Well, thank you again, Kurt. We appreciate it.
Yeah, I enjoyed the interview.
Thank you. And thank you, our guests, for watching our show today. I'm Nannette Nocon. My guest was Kurt Feuerherm. And until next time, it's about money.